Have you or a loved one ever experienced hearing loss? Hearing loss can result from several causes, including exposure to excessive noise, certain medications, aging, disease, and heredity. According to the NIH, approximately 1 in 3 people between the ages of 65 and 74 has hearing loss, and nearly half of those older than 75 has difficulty hearing. There are 4 main types of hearing loss: conductive, sensorineural, mixed, and central hearing impairment. Conductive hearing loss occurs when sound conduction is impaired from traveling through the external ear, the middle ear, or both. Generally, it affects low frequencies first and can progress to affect all frequencies. Examples of low frequency sounds are a rumble of thunder, and examples of high frequency sounds are a whistle or bird chirping. Sensorineural hearing loss occurs when there is a problem within the cochlea or the cochlear nerve transmitting the sensory information. High-frequency hearing loss refers to trouble hearing sounds from 2,000 to 8,000 Hz range and is often lost first in sensorineural hearing loss. A person can also experience mixed hearing loss, which is some combination of the two. A central hearing impairment involves issues with the neural pathways from the brainstem cochlear nucleus to the auditory cortex. The pathway for hearing is bilateral, and differences in arrival time of a sound between two ears, which is also known as interaural time difference, and its processing is important in the localization of sounds. To test whether a patient has hearing loss, a whisper test can first be used to determine if there are differences between perception of sounds in the left and right ears. The doctor will examine the patient by looking down the auditory canal using an otoscope. Full audiometric testing may be ordered to examine the specific types of hearing loss. Sometimes patients may exhibit other symptoms besides hearing loss, such as balance issues or vertigo. Why would this be the case? The inner ear contains the cochlea, but it also contains specialized structures for our vestibular sense. The semicircular canals and vestibule are situated medial to the eardrum or tympanic membrane and behind the cochlea. A separate nerve transmits vestibular information, but together the two nerves travel together into the brainstem through the internal acoustic meatus and are called the vestibulocochlear nerve. This is also known as the eighth cranial nerve. The semicircular canals respond to rotational movements, which is also known as angular acceleration, while the vestibular structures respond to changes in the position of the head with respect to gravity, which is also called linear acceleration. Balance issues have many causes: medications, ear infections, a head injury, or anything else that affects the inner ear or brain can cause balance issues. Low blood pressure can lead to dizziness when you stand up too quickly, but this is not related to diseases or disorders of the inner ear. Going on high altitudes, such as going on a flight, may cause changes in equilibrium. Yawning or chewing gum opens the eustachian tube and allows air to flow into or out of the middle ear. This helps equalize pressure on either side of the eardrum. The area where the vestibulocochlear nerve enters the brainstem is called the cerebellopontine angle, the lateral part of the junction between the pons and medulla. This is also known as the pontomedullary junction. Along with the eighth cranial nerve, other cranial nerves are found in this region. The cranial nerves are ordered anteriorly to posteriorly, with cranial nerves 1 through 4 entering the brain or midbrain above this area. Cranial nerve number 5, the trigeminal nerve, enters the brainstem in the mid-pons and is responsible for detecting touch, pain, and temperature from all parts of the ipsilateral face. A smaller motor component of the trigeminal nerve's third or mandibular branch also helps move the jaw during mastication or chewing. Cranial nerve number 6 is the abducens nerve. Activation of this nerve will cause the ipsilateral eye to move laterally or abduct. It is a motor nerve, so its axons exit the brainstem near the midline at the junction between the pons and the medulla oblongata. Cranial nerve number 7 is the facial nerve. It is a mixed nerve, which means it has sensory, motor, and autonomic functions. Its main role is to move the muscles of ipsilateral facial expression. However, it also has sensory roles in detecting taste from the front of the tongue and autonomic functions in activating salivary and lacrimal glands. Like the vestibulocochlear nerve, it travels from the inner ear through the small hole in the petrous portion of the temporal bone called the internal acoustic meatus to reach the posterior fossa where the brainstem sits. A small artery called the labyrinthine artery also travels through this hole in most people. Cranial nerve number 8 is the vestibulocochlear nerve. It originates in the inner ear, shown here in blue. Cranial nerve number 9 is the glossopharyngeal nerve. It, too, is a mixed nerve that carries afferent ipsilateral sensory information from, for example, the posterior tongue taste buds and efferent motor control of the stylopharyngeus muscle, which elevates the larynx and pharynx during speaking and swallowing. It also has autonomic functions like activating the parotid salivary gland and carrying information about blood pressure and blood gases from the carotid sinus and body. It exits the brainstem out from the sides of the upper medulla, just anterior to the vagus nerve. Beginning anatomy students can often recognize the cranial nerves from a ventral view of the brain by identifying their anterior to posterior location. But in clinical settings, these structures are identified in cross-sectional scanning modalities like computed tomography, or CT, and magnetic resonance imaging, or MRIs. In CTs or MRIs, the transverse or axial view is common, where the brain is divided into superior and inferior sections. When the cross-sectional image is observed, the convention is to have the anterior or nose side at the top of the image and the posterior cerebellum side at the bottom. The right side of the person's brain is on the left side of the image, as the images are shown from an inferior view typically. This image is taken from a T1 weighted MRI. Fluids like cerebrospinal fluid appear dark, and the brain tissue appears white or gray. Dark areas may also represent air spaces or canals within bone, and here you can see temporal bone air spaces lateral to the cerebellum. In this section through the pontomedullary junction, the eighth cranial nerve can be observed on either side of the brainstem, which are indicated by the thick blue arrows. This is a peripheral nerve, so it is myelinated by Schwann cell glia, whereas the neurons coming from the cochlear nucleus that ascend up the brainstem are myelinated by central nervous system myelinating cells called oligodendrocytes. A rare, slow-growing type of tumor can form on the eighth cranial nerve called the vestibular schwannoma. This can cause problems with hearing and balance in this area, and as the tumor begins to grow, it can also press on nearby structures. One nearby structure is a part of the ventricular system. The ventricles are cerebrospinal fluid-filled communicating cavities at the center of the brain. CSF is produced in the ventricles and then flows down through the center of the brain and brainstem, then out through apertures in the fourth ventricles to the subarachnoid space surrounding the brain. The subarachnoid space is an area between two layers of the brain meninges, the arachnoid and pia maters. If flow through the ventricles is blocked due to obstruction or brain herniation, hydrocephalus or water on the brain can ensue. This can be very painful and even deadly in an adult, as intracranial pressure increases and pushes on nearby brain structures. If there is a tear or a hole in the outermost layer of the meninges, called the dura mater, the increased pressure can lead to leakage through thin areas at the skull base, leading to drainage out of the nose or any point along the spinal column. Hydrocephalus is commonly treated by inserting a shunt into the lateral ventricle with the drain into the abdomen, which is also known as the ventriculoperitoneal shunt. When a person has trouble with this deep brain region, there are only a few surgical approaches to get inside of this cavity where the brain is contained. This cavity is called the posterior fossa. If a person undergoes brain surgery, typical recovery times vary, but would include weeks to months of rehabilitation, including therapy related to hearing, vestibular, motor, and sometimes cognitive deficits. Hearing loss, whatever its cause, can make it difficult to carry on conversations with friends and family. But a person may also have trouble understanding doctor's advice or have an inability to respond to alarms or warnings. If you or your family member has hearing loss, balance issues, or any other difficulties with the cranial nerves or brain structures we discussed in this video, please see your doctor. In class, we will apply this material to a real-life case of a college professor who experienced some of the symptoms we described here.